every time you travel, get something for your husband. You know, I told you I was in Kenya, I led my students, and when I was coming, I got to this mall and I saw this trophy, World's Best Husband. So I picked it, and my husband and I were on that trip, so I tried to hide it in a way that the next thing I saw my students, they were all going there to buy. I said, oh, this is good. So I said, I've never given my husband any gift. I said, what? You must, not just on his birthday. I write letters to my husband. I post it and he receives it. Just to say I love him. Sometimes I just wake him up in the dead of the night. Not for sex, not for anything, but to just validate him. And let him know how special he is. Not that every time you wake your husband up, it is for quarrel. In the afternoon, when you were talking. Surprise him. Make him happy. The devil will try to make you not happy. But please make him happy. Please. Stop thinking like it's the man that must always make you happy. You too. You must. Let your husband know that you did not waste his life by him marrying you. Let him know that it's not a crime. The Bible says, for this reason shall a man leave his father, L-E-A-V-E, five letter words, and cleave to his wife, six letter words, C-L-E-A-V-E. That means after marriage, your husband's life must be better. If not, you are a witch. Somebody said, you are a witch, is now, you know. It's just my vernacular way of saying you are not normal. So your husband's life must improve. Repackage him. This thing is in repackaging. Repackage him and let him be happy. After this conference, start doing all these things. Take with your husband, you know, take him on a date, you know, invite him to dinner, present him a bouquet, write letters to him. Sometimes you use a piece of chalk or your eyebrow pencil to write, I love you. Just something crazy. And those of you that call your husbands by their first names, from today, look for a pet name. Babe, honey, sweetheart, something. After this conference, say, we've been married 20 years, it doesn't matter. When you get home and you start, and your husband says, what is all this? When did we start? I say, we're just starting now. It's never late to start. I have different names for my husband, depending on what I need. When I call him darling, that's normal. When I call him baby, he knows it's going to be serious tonight. When you hear me say Bishop FAA, I'm asking for money. So I'm reminding him that he's a man of God and he must take care of his family. Husband who calls me all sorts of names. He calls me darling. When you hear him, he calls me Funke baby. Because my name is Funke. When you hear my husband say a Funke baby, that means I'm angry and he's trying to appease me. A Funke baby. Whether I like it or not, I'm just trying to be careful. I don't like it, or you know. And then it's over. If you give him a pet name, he will also give you a pet name. So please make him happy. The man is tense. All sorts of things happening to him. You know, be his shock absorber. Sometimes it's not easy. He's betrayed. His expectations are not met. He's broke. No man wants to be broke. He can't meet his manly duties and responsibilities. Be there for him. Support him. Make him happy. Don't allow your husband alone to pay the school fees. Help him. That's why you need your own as a woman. Please, I ask that you be a mother indeed and a matriarch, not just in title, but in reality. Let your husband know that you are there. So that when you are older and you also need help, he will be there for you. I read a book written by T.D. Jakes. When his wife was involved in an accident, and for a long time, T.D. Jakes had to be pushing her in the wheelchair. Somebody said to T.D. Jakes, "Are you not tired of pushing this woman?" He said, "I am believing God for a miracle. But this woman has done so much that I am ready to push her in this wheelchair throughout my life." I was preaching recently and I asked the ladies a question. When David was going to marry Michal, the Bible says that the father said, "I don't want money, I don't want anything, just give me 100 foreskins of the Philistines." You know what a foreskin is? That's not easy. That means he's going to kill the people and then take from their private part. That was wicked on Saul's part. But that was what he wanted as dowry. Hear what David said. "I will not just give you 100, I'll give you 200, because this woman deserves it." And I'm going to ask you the same question. If your husband were to repay your dowry, will he reduce it or increase it? By reason of what you have contributed to his life in these last 5 years that you've been married, or 10 years, or 30 years, will he reduce it? Because some women are thorns in their husband's lives, rottenness in their bones. Many people condemn Michal. I don't. When I preach about worship and all that, I bring out lessons from her life. But excuse me, that woman stood out. For a man to say, "I will double your dowry." Do you know that after David had become the king, after Saul died and all that, and David got back to the throne, the Bible says that David said, "Bring back Michal for me." By this time, Michal was married. And when she was being brought to the king, her new husband followed her crying. That's to tell you what that woman weighed. The old husband gave double the bride price. The new husband was crying. And the person said, "You better go back, if I will kill you," before the man now went back. That's how to be a relevant woman.